Hey guys, thanks for joining me and welcome to the Holy Shed, which you may discern is actually in the real shed this week. And I'm so happy to be here. Next week I'll be back in London, but here I am today. And one of the things that I did last week in London, as you may know, was to join Zoe Ball on the BBC for A Pause for Thought. And some of you are asking where it is, because you didn't get up early enough to listen, or you were busy, or you're on your way to work, or whatever, and it hasn't appeared as yet on BBC Sounds. Well, I don't know what it's all about. It's some kind of hitch. I am assured that it is not just mine that has gone astray, but it may appear. I don't know. But meanwhile, I've made my own rather rough copy of the talk, of the Pause for Thought, from the whole program recording, and I will post that later, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, I'm not sure. Anyway, I've got quite a bit to get through this week, so let me press on. Because with the events of Holy Week behind us now, I thought it would be a pretty good time to look back on it all dispassionately, as it were, and ponder the whole business of why Jesus died in the way that he did, and what are the consequences of that? In other words, excuse me, we're looking at atonement theory. Now, the word theory, I know, is guaranteed to wind up some people for whom this is nothing to do with theory. It's just simple fact. And it's a fact or a narrative which goes a little bit like this. We're sinners, just by virtue of being born, by the way. We're sinners. We therefore deserve to be punished, by which read, spend eternity tormented in hell. However, because that's not great, but we can't possibly atone for our sin, God punished Jesus on the cross instead. And now, if we trust in what that achieved, God forgives us and we get to spend eternity in heaven instead. Now, make no mistake, this is a theory. It's a construct. It's a constructed interpretation, sometimes known as substitutionary atonement, and sometimes penal atonement or penal substitution, which sounds like something you could maybe get an ointment for. But anyway, joking aside, I am far from alone in rejecting this utterly, not least because it portrays God in such a bad light. It portrays a God, actually, that I can't even begin to believe in. It also promotes the notion of redemptive violence inadvertently. It promotes the notion of redemptive violence, the idea that perceived problems can be solved through punishment or through violent retribution. This is a mentality which has devastating consequences for targets of abuse, by the way. And anyway, where's the logic? Where's the common sense in the whole thing? You know, that someone could be forgiven, you know, because of an innocent person who had nothing to do with it being punished instead. I mean, where is the logic in that? In this substitutionary atonement theory, it seems to me that rather than being saved from sin or healed of our flaws or whatever, we're actually saved from God. You know, we're saved from this angry, avenging God who has some kind of mental ledger that can only be balanced through someone being violently punished through the shedding of blood, as the mantra tells us over and over. All in all, I have to say, this is not a religion that I can believe in. Not at least while at the same time I'm maintaining the moral values that I believe God gave me, or while remaining a follower of Jesus who explicitly rejects retributive justice. I mean, you know, there are lots of instances I could give of that, but the story of the prodigal son is one straight off. But also, remember Jesus telling Peter, when Peter said, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? And Jesus said, 70 times 7, which is another way of saying without limit, you know. Now, I know I'll be called a heretic again, but hey, that penal substitution theory is basically pollocks. I said pollocks, by the way. I could say other things. Now, someone would also say, but it's all in the Bible. It's what the Bible teaches. Well, no, actually. The New Testament does not have any single systematic explanation of atonement theory, you know, least of all penal substitution. And the verses mostly put forward to support that narrative that I've just described can and I think definitely should be understood in a quite different way, which I believe is more faithful to what the authors actually intended. But you know what? If the Bible plainly taught penal substitution or something like it, you know, the sort of thing I've just described, then I would still absolutely reject it on the most basic theological grounds, which is the way that it depicts God. It's just the most appalling. And this is where, you know, people like Richard Dawkins has a heyday with this kind of thing, but lots of other people too. In the world of theology, atonement theory is constructed around several models or frameworks that draw on various biblical texts plus ideas outside of the text, which are then woven together into a narrative which, as such, does not exist in the Bible in the first place. Because, as I say, there is no singular model or explanation of what the cross means or achieves in the New Testament. It's not there. It has to be constructed from little statements and verses here, there, and everywhere. I'd like to explain the process by pinpointing four windows through which we can view the cross. Actually, you could use these same windows to look at and contemplate and reflect on various other things, like the resurrection, for example. And what I'm going to do now, in fact, is for most of the rest of this time, is sort of shufty over to one side of the screen, because I'm going to have an illustration before you of what I'm talking about. So here are the four windows that I'm suggesting that we might look through to try and understand and reflect on the cross and the meaning of the cross. So there are historical facts, and then what I'm calling metaphysical or spiritual consequences of those facts. And then there are the theological models to interpret the facts and the metaphysical consequences. Okay. And then fourthly, there's the testimony of people throughout history as to what the cross means to them. You know, the personal and probably also social impact that they have had. Okay. So critics tend to complain that the Gospels can't really be considered history, that they are, you know, something, a biased account, shall we say, by believers. And, you know, they are, as Marcus Borg has put it, a mixture of memory, metaphor, and faith. Okay, memory being where we might expect facts to be, metaphor that gives meaning to the story, and faith being the affirmations of what people had come to believe about Jesus. Now, none of that is saying that the Gospels are untrue. I think they are one of the main source of information that we have about Jesus, which I, for one, accept, albeit critically, by which I take into account the fact that they are not pure history in the sense that we nowadays think of history. But, you know, truth is not always the same as literal fact, as I keep on saying. It's one of the mantras of the Holy Shed. However, you know, the crucifixion as an event is corroborated outside of the Gospels as a historical event by two Roman historians, Josephus and Tacitus, both of whom talk about Jesus as a real person who lived in Palestine and was eventually crucified by the Romans. And it appears, as far as I can see, that Jesus was executed by the Romans at the instigation of the temple authorities, basically as a convenient scapegoat. You know, Jewish authorities were understandably fearful of turbulent uprisings within their midst because they provoked angry responses from the Roman occupier. And so they tended to work together with the Romans to maintain the peace. And, you know, as a popular figure who opposed oppression, who stood up for ordinary people, who criticized the authorities, Jesus was an obvious, perfect scapegoat when the trouble was rising up around the time of these events that were told about in the Gospels, around the Passover time. And it did seem to be that it was at the great Jewish feasts that things heated up. And so, you know, Pilate, who didn't reside in Jerusalem, he resided out on the coast, came in at the Passover and other times with a whole bunch of his army, you know, his henchmen, to come and make sure that the peace was kept. And so it was all brewing up there, and Jesus was the perfect scapegoat. But of course, Christians claim that there was more to it than that. That, yes, he was crucified by the Romans at the instigation of Jewish authorities, but his death had some kind of objective effect outside of the realm of everyday existence. In other words, what we call metaphysical or spiritual consequences, which have been described in various ways, some of which I've highlighted here. But I want you particularly to notice that I've made this window opaque, because there can be no clear vision through this window, no proof or objective collaboration of any of the things that it's claimed by Christians happened as objective realities as a result of Jesus dying. This window is visible only by the eyes of faith. You know, it's a mystery. And some may say it would be a lot better if we left it there as a mystery. But these are some of the things that people, Christians, traditionally claim happened as a result of Jesus dying on the cross. Now, this is where we come to the interesting third window, which, you know, is the window that reveals the ways that Christians have interpreted those previous two windows. You know, the facts that we have and the metaphysical consequences, spiritual consequences, have been interpreted. And the ways that the two things have been woven together with a combination of biblical texts, beliefs, metaphors, and reason results in these various models or theories. And by the way, cultural factors at the time would also inevitably play a part. So, you know, these sort of models here are not sort of read out of the Bible. They use bits of the Bible together with other beliefs that are brought to the process, and inevitable cultural impacts as well, to result in these. So let's just look at them. The earliest theories were the ransom model and Christus Victor. And these two are actually very closely related. These two models pretty much held sway for the first 1,000 years of church history. Both are based, of course, on the belief that through their disobedience in the garden, Adam and Eve sold out humankind to the devil. And that's how, you know, the whole story was originally interpreted. It was the fact that they had sold out humankind to Satan. And this left us all forever in bondage to Satan. Christus Victor asserts that what God did was trick the devil into believing that he had conquered Jesus on the cross. But then, wow, you know, Jesus rose again and Satan was defeated, meaning that we can be free from our original sin. And if you look at, Eastern Orthodox icons of the cross, or you go back into early writings, you'll find this theme is what appears again and again, that it was all about Jesus conquering over Satan and the powers of hell in order for us to be released. Okay? Ransom theory argues that due to human bondage after the garden, a ransom needed to be paid to Satan to redeem humankind. And so, in some kind of contractual agreement, God handed over his son as the ransom, and the devil consequently killed Jesus. But once again, bam, Jesus conquered death and hell, and we were liberated. The resurrection happened, which was a big sort of surprise to Satan. So Jesus conquered death and hell, and we were liberated. This is basically, if you're familiar with it, the model that C.S. Lewis adopts in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. You remember that? It's a wonderful story. I'm always moved by it when I read it or see it in film. It's where Aslan, the great lion, allows himself to be killed by the Wicked Witch so that Edmund could be freed from the icy grip of the Wicked Witch because he had sided with her. But then Aslan returns alive again to overthrow her power. And so it's the same kind of story. And neither of these was there a threat of divine wrath on humans because of sin, as I mentioned it earlier. That did not appear in these early understandings of the atonement. In The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, Edmund felt shame for siding with the Wicked Witch, but Aslan was never angry with him. That's not the story. The focus in ransom theory and Christus Victor is on deliverance from the powers of the devil and hell. Okay, so fast forward to the 12th century, where Anselm, who was the Archbishop of Canterbury, constructs what's called the satisfaction model of atonement, which held that we have all robbed God of his honour through sin, so a debt is now owed. And for it to be paid, something greater than all creation needed to be offered. Now, only humans could pay the debt, and yet only God could offer the equivalent to everything in creation. So the debt had to be paid in full. So what better solution, Anselm argued, than for God to become human and, as a human, pay what was owed. So in this sort of, satisfaction theory, gone are the bargains with the devil, which Anselm himself loathed. And that's what he was shifting away from. But at what cost did he move away from them? Well, the cost was a very weird picture of God, I reckon. I mentioned that culture is a factor in atonement theories. The ransom and Christus Victor models reflect the paranoid, dualistic, good and evil world of the ancients. Satisfaction theory, however, is much more the product of Anselm's world. And it's highlighted very well, actually, by the Catholic theologian Richard McBrien, who argues this, if I can just pull it up. He says, Anselm's theory is to be understood against the background of the Germanic and early medieval feudal system. There is a bond of honour between the feudal lord and the vassal. Infringement of the lord's honour is tantamount to an assault upon the whole feudal system. A demand for satisfaction, therefore, is not for the sake of appeasing the lord's personal sense of honour, but for the sake of restoring order to the universe, the feudal system, in which, and therefore against which, the sin was committed. The feudal lord, he said, cannot simply overlook the offence because the order of his whole economic and social world is at stake. So too, he says, with God in Anselm's vision of atonement. So I don't know if you're sort of grasping that. It's sort of what he's saying is it's kind of rooted in that feudal system where, you know, when a lord in, you know, a superior in society was offended, there had to be a debt. There was a debt was created which had to be paid in order that the whole system, the world order as they knew it, could be maintained. Now, the Protestant reformers, Luther and Calvin, some hundreds of years later, modified Anselm's theory and gave it a more explicitly legal framework in what is now called penal substitution, penal obviously being legal. And they gave it a much more sort of legal forensic framework in which human sin is an offence against divine law. So suddenly you've got this whole legal thing come in, and there's this law that, you know, we through sin have offended against, which has to be punished. The law says so. And Jesus is punished to satisfy God's justice and wrath against human sin that's broken the law. God can then forgive us because of the punishment that Jesus suffered. And this is a balancing of a ledger, really. And this balancing of the ledgers is actually at the core of this theory, which claims that Jesus died for legal satisfaction purposes. Me, I'm with Walter Wink, the theologian, New Testament theologian, who asks, what is wrong with this God? I like that kind of theologian. What is wrong with this God whose legal ledgers can be balanced only by means of the death of an innocent victim? I agree. I mean, beyond the bounds of this crazy legal or penal transaction, how can the sacrifice of an innocent victim do the job? How can it make any difference? And how can we make sense of a basically schizophrenic deity who all of a sudden changes his attitude toward people when someone else, an innocent victim, by the way, dies in their place? You know, to me, little wonder that so many people turn their back on such a monstrous notion of God. As Walter Wink again says, against such an image of God, the revolt of atheism is an act of pure religion. Amen, I say. So what else is there? Well, interestingly, there was a contemporary of Anselm called Peter Abelard. And Peter Abelard completely rejected the Archbishop of Canterbury's explanation about a debt needing to be paid and substitution and all that kind of stuff. Instead, he took a radical turn. He came up with something that we now call moral influence. Abelard's writings, we should know, are driven basically by two big concerns. One, his interest in romantic love. His love letters to Heloise are famous and preserved to this day. He was madly in love, and that played a big part in his life. Love was central to him. I mean, I have to say I like him already. But secondly, that plays out big time in his writings is a concern for ethics. These occupy a huge part in Abelard's writings. So these two things, love and ethics. So when it comes to the atonement, these two things flowed together for Abelard. The cross has the potential to change our behaviour because in the crucified Jesus, who even forgives his killers as they're killing him, we come to understand something of the mammoth proportions of divine love. And this becomes not just an example, as it's sometimes portrayed, but a mighty, powerful force and influence within us to live a different way, more righteous, more loving. And that's how we're saved from our sins. Through this almighty, not just a demonstration, but a living out and acting out of this love that was always there and always will be there, but was and often is still invisible to so many people. This was a kind of acting out of that which unlocked the powerful potential of God's love in our lives. So this approach isn't about changing the way God feels towards us, the way God views humankind. In this model, there is no anger, wrath, or punishment, but rather, in this model, it's about changing the ways that we understand and respond to God's love. So I need hardly say that Abelard's model has got great appeal to me. I feel great affinity with that, far more than the others that I've already mentioned. But then, more recently, a new and engaging model of atonement has emerged, largely influenced by the thought of the French philosopher René Girard, who was converted to Christianity actually through reading the gospel narratives of the crucifixion. So this was a really important sort of storyline and text to Girard. And his approach is commonly known as scapegoat theory or non-violent atonement. Now, scapegoating, it's a word we use, isn't it? Scapegoating is as old as human society. You could say it's an original sin within human experience, because right back to the dawn of time, to the dawn of societies anyway, human society, scapegoating has been part, a characteristic of human life. And there's a mechanism to it, really. And the scapegoating mechanism goes a bit like this. There's some kind of perceived evil that threatens society or the social order. Now, that could be a natural disaster. It could be a pandemic, economic instability, a divergent lifestyle, whatever. So you've got this threat to the social order. So an innocent victim ends up getting blamed or scapegoated, maybe punished, banished, or at least marginalised, so that order can be restored. It may at times just be violent in attitude. You know, bullying is a form of scapegoating, isn't it? Or it may be literal violence. And you know, there are lots of examples. I mean, the things that I've just mentioned there. It's interesting. I've heard American televangelists saying that gay people are to blame for, you know, storm this, that, or the other in America through natural disasters. You know, Donald Trump described famously the pandemic as the Chinese disease. Economic instability is blamed on migrants sometimes. And the AIDS crisis clearly was the result of gay people and so on. So whoever, in whatever way it is, an innocent victim is scapegoated and needs to be punished. And in that way, order can be restored. Scapegoating theory, or this particular model, sees Jesus as the ultimate scapegoat. That's how Girard saw him. Jesus was the ultimate scapegoat or victim of violence. So yes, Jesus was the scapegoat who on the cross became, in a reverse of circumstances, became God's judgment on scapegoating. So what Girard's saying is Jesus became a scapegoat to condemn scapegoating. I think we could also see the death of Jesus on the cross as a judgment on theories like penal substitution atonement, which is itself a form of scapegoating of the worst kind, because God is scapegoating Jesus. It's through the death of him that order is restored. Walter Wink, to quote him again, states that penal substitution can be seen as a crime against divinity. James Allison, who is a key articulator of the scapegoating theory of atonement, summarizes it like this. He says, and I quote, "Christianity is a priestly religion which understands that it is God's overcoming of our violence by substituting himself for the victim of our typical sacrifices that opens up our being able to enjoy the fullness of creation as if death were not. So, you know, it's a new order becomes possible because, you know, of God becoming the victim of scapegoating in the person of Jesus. Of course, these models of atonement are not necessarily mutually exclusive. For example, you know, the scapegoating, or I like better calling it the non-violent theory, lends itself to a more, you know, lends itself to a more socio-political interpretation of the cross, but it could easily be intertwined with Abelard's moral influence model, or even with Christus Victor. So, hey guys, I have talked quite enough for 1 week, and it's a lot of stuff to take in, I know, but I'm trying to, you know, make it as straightforward and understandable as possible because, you know, there are so many books, so much literature out there about it, but they tend at times to be pretty complicated and quite technical. But anyway, I'm going to continue with this next time because, as I say, I know it's a lot to take in, and especially I would like to look a bit more at the scapegoating or non-violent approach and how that fits with others, and also reveal more clearly where I float my boat in these choppy waters of atonement theory. Meanwhile, I think I'd like you just to remember this. The English word atonement, the Saxon word atonement, has its roots in being at one with. Okay? And so it's best perhaps seen as at one meant, two dashes put in, at one meant. Nothing to do with all the elaborate theories. The cross is where God seeks to be at one with us through the gift of his limitless love. So I hope, that sort of makes some kind of sense to you out of all of these things. Of course, the interesting thing is then you've got this fourth window, which is to do with personal impacts, because, you know, people do claim, as a result of an encounter with the crucified Jesus, that a new beginning is brought. I mean, some people speak of new birth, don't they? A new relationship with God is found, liberation from guilt, hope, and of course, new life in God's kingdom. So taking these four windows together, we get a little bit of an idea of how the atonement models work. But as I say, next week we shall look at it all. Oh gosh, I've come back again. We shall look at it all in another way to try to make a bit more sense of it. I think the important thing underneath of it all is this question of who do I believe God is? What kind of God can I believe in? And if you take those models and just contemplate them a little, how much do any of them, or which of them, reflects the sense of God that you live with in your own heart and your own mind? Okay, well, I'm going to come up with not so much a prayer now as an affirmation arising from these things. And this is, I suppose, my little credo as a result of reflection on atonement theory. I believe in accountability for actions, but always with healing as its objective. I believe in restorative justice, not revenge. Revenge brings forth in its own likeness. Restorative compassion opens up new possibilities. I believe violence never truly solves a problem, but is very good at creating more problems. I believe the path of love is always the better way, that forgiveness and reconciliation pave the road to heaven. I believe kindness is powerfully redemptive, the very heart of what grace means, but emasculated when muddled with being nice. I believe atonement is a beautiful way of saying, let grace and forgiveness prevail, and pounds of flesh be set aside. I don't believe the crucifixion changes God's mind toward us, but rather invites us to change our mind toward God. I believe in divine unilateral forgiveness, in a prodigal God who always welcomes and pardons, who never corks the fount of possibility in us, even when we're at our worst. I believe in eternal goodness, which has no need of wrath, never sinks to vengeance, is repulsed by violence, knows no end to magnanimity or the will to reconcile. The gracious presence in which all things must ultimately converge. Amen. Lot to take in, hey? But you can look at it as many times as you want. Me, I've got a bit of a tickle, and I've got just the thing to solve it here. So I'm going to propose a toast. If you have something to drink there with you, then I invite you to join me now. In a toast to love that demands nothing. A toast to victims of abuse, may they find justice and liberation. A toast to knowing that nothing can ever change God's mind toward us. Nothing we can do will ever make him turn away from us. That's a good thought, isn't it? To life. L'chaim. Well, there we are. Thank you for joining me today, and I hope that you'll come back for part two next week. Next time you're around, and I'm going to play you out with a song which always brings tears to my eyes, because regardless of the words, there's something about the spirit of this song that makes the heart of what we've been talking about real to me. It's called Pretty Amazing Grace. Meanwhile, guys, have a great week. Be kind. Be kind to yourselves, most of all. Be kind to people round about you. Be kind to this lovely planet and its creatures. Stay human. And I'll see you soon.
Pretty amazing grace is what you showed me. Pretty amazing grace is who you are. I was an empty vessel. You filled me up inside. And with amazing grace, restored my pride. Pretty amazing grace is how you saved me. And with amazing grace, reclaimed my heart. Love in the midst of chaos, calm in the heat of war. Show with amazing grace what love was for. Forgave my insensitivity and my attempt to then mislead you. You stood beside a wretch like me. Show your amazing grace. When grace was what I needed, stumbled inside the doorway of your chapel. And awed by everything I found. Beauty and love surround me, freed me from what I fear. Ask for amazing grace and you appear. See you.
Pretty amazing, isn't it? The old man does it to me every time. See you soon, guys.